In this video, we will talk about the Dirac equation and the move from non-relativistic quantum mechanics to relativistic quantum mechanics, which gives us quantum field theory. We are going to discuss why the Schrödinger equation doesn't work in quantum field theory and discuss the work of Dirac and his equation. Finally, we will discuss the predictions and significance of the Dirac equation and how it has helped push physics forwards. The Dirac equation was derived by British physicist Paul Dirac in 1928, only 2 years after Schrödinger had introduced his famous Schrödinger equation, which today is one of the core equations of quantum mechanics. Needless to say that progress was going fast in those days. What is the problem with the Schrödinger equation? In order to appreciate the work of Dirac, we must first understand what problem he was trying to resolve. To do that, we must go back to 1905, where Einstein changed the world with his postulates of special relativity. He showed that the speed of light is constant, and that the speed of light is a speed limit we cannot cross. Furthermore, he united space and time and introduced space-time. The important thing he realized is that space and time are linked together. This was groundbreaking. We learned that to describe objects which move close to the speed of light, we must consider space-time as a united entity. Thus, we must treat space and time on equal footing. This is the crux of the problem with the Schrödinger equation. If we look at the Schrödinger equation without any potential, thus that of a free particle, minus h bar squared divided by 2m times the Laplacian of psi is equal to I h bar and the derivative with respect to time. We see that on the left side we have the double derivative with respect to the spatial coordinates x, y and z, which is indicated by the Laplace squared or the Laplacian. On the right hand side we have a single derivative with respect to time, as the Schrödinger equation does not treat space and time equally. This is the reason why this equation doesn't work for describing space-time, and thus it doesn't work for fast objects. This means that the Schrödinger equation is not a relativistic equation and cannot correctly describe objects moving close to the speed of light. As it turns out, we have actually already discussed an equation in the introduction to quantum field theory that is relativistic. That is the Klein-Gordon equation, which was discovered around the same time as the Schrödinger equation, and it was initially proposed that it could describe electrons in 1926. This is however not the case, and the only particle which we have discovered which follows the Klein-Gordon equation is the Higgs boson. This equation can be written as 1 over c squared times the double derivative with respect to t of psi and minus the Laplacian of psi plus m squared c squared divided by h bar squared times psi is equal to 0. Where we now have a factor of c squared for good measure and this extra mass term with the mass m and Planck's constant h bar. As it turns out, we generally see the constant c in relativistic equations, but we usually don't write it because we usually use natural units. This is when we just set h bar and 0 equal to 1 to make the notation nicer and work with the unit electron volt. The important thing about this equation is that now we have a double derivative with respect to time and with respect to space. Thus, this equation treats space and time equally, and it therefore works as a relativistic equation considering space-time. The problem with the Klein-Gordon equation is, however, that it doesn't work to describe electrons. It describes spin zero particles like the Higgs boson. So what do we do? One of the problems with the Klein-Gordon equation is that it is second order. By this I mean that we consider double derivatives with respect to space-time. We all know that if you take a real number and square it, you get a positive number. Thus both 2 squared and minus 2 squared is equal to 4. Thus we lose information about signs. If we take the square root of 4, we get that the result is either minus or plus 2. we don't know which sign is correct, and thus we lose information. This is part of the problem, and as it turns out, equations describing spin half particles are first order, thus there is just one derivative with respect to spacetime, not two. The second order result is however rather natural, because in special relativity the definition of energy itself is second order. E squared is equal to p squared c squared plus m squared c to the fourth. The solution seems to be simple. We just need to take the square root and then everything should be fine. It however turns out that things are not so simple in the case of taking the square root of the Klein-Gordon equation. That is because, as it turns out, the first order equation that we are looking for is actually a complex equation with imaginary numbers, unlike the Klein-Gordon equation where we only have real components. Now that we know the background story, let us look at how Dirac solved it. As we already realized, the solution is somehow to take the square root of the Klein-Gordon equation. Eventually, he originally proposed the following solution. In parentheses, beta mc squared plus c and the sum from 1 to 3 of alpha n pn, end of parenthesis, psi is equal to I h bar and the derivative of psi with respect to time. Firstly, this equation resembles the Schrödinger equation a bit, and also the Klein-Gordon equation. In fact, in this form it may look a bit like the crossbreed of the Schrödinger equation and the square root of the Klein-Gordon equation, which it basically is. Now, we have some components, namely the two new parameters beta and alpha n, which we must somehow figure out. The first term has the mass term mc squared, just like in Einstein's famous equation E equals to mc squared. So we have a mass term like in the Klein-Gordon equation. The next term is just the sum of the x, y and z component of the momentum operator. Note that the definition of the momentum is pn is equal to minus ih and the derivative with respect to the spatial components, xn. Thus this is the first order derivative of the spatial component, just like we wanted. On the right hand side, it just looks like the Schrödinger equation, and we have this first order derivative of the time component. Thus in this equation, both space and time is first order. This is exactly what we need, a first order equation for space-time. And this was the original proposal by Dirac, and thus the original Dirac equation. But we still didn't really solve the problem, because we didn't figure out what the values of beta and alpha should be for this to work. It turns out that these two parameters are the magic that makes this equation work for fermions. These terms turn out to represent a spin-up and a spin-down particle, and also a spin-up and spin-down antiparticle. Thus Dirac predicted antiparticles with his equation. Initially, no one believed in such particles, and therefore the consensus was that the Dirac equation was wrong. But lo and behold, only a few years later, in 1932, the positron or anti-electron was discovered, and thus the first antiparticle had been discovered, matching exactly the prediction of the Dirac equation. Because these spin components are absent in the Klein-Gordon equation, we know that the square, thus beta squared and alpha squared, is equal to 1, such that the components do not appear in the Klein-Gordon equation. With such constraints, the values of beta and alpha were determined. In modern days, we now write the Dirac equation in terms of the so-called gamma matrices, which you can obtain from solving the beta and alpha parameters. The matrices can be written as gamma 0, gamma 1, gamma 2 and gamma 3, where I2 is the 2 times 2 identity matrices, and the sigma matrices are the 3 Pauli spin matrices that we know from spin objects in quantum mechanics. With the help of these gamma matrices, we can write the Dirac equation in a more familiar and compact form without these mysterious beta and alpha parameters as, in parentheses, I h bar gamma mu partial differential mu minus mc, and all multiplied by psi is equal to 0, where mu is an index summing over all 4 space-time components, and partial derivative mu is the derivative of each space-time component. Thus we consider time and the xyz component. we can recognize that this equation is exactly the component in QED that describes the movement of electrons and other fermions, which is what Dirac was searching for, and this formed the foundation for QED. Now the last thing we need to do is to check that we didn't do any mistakes on the way. Recall that the Dirac equation should be the square root of the Klein-Gordon equation, so let us now square it. Because this equation is complex, this means that we must multiply it with the complex conjugate. This means that the sign in front of the imaginary number I change, and we obtain in parentheses I h bar gamma mu positive function mu minus mc times in parentheses minus I h bar gamma mu partial derivative mu minus mc, and all that times psi is equal to zero. Multiplying everything together gives us h bar squared, the partial derivative of mu squared, plus m squared c squared, and all that times psi is equal to zero, which is the Klein-Gordon equation. If we divide with h bar and expand partial derivative of mu squared, we get the exact form as shown earlier in this video. In this video, we have looked a bit at the foundation of quantum field theory and discussed why the Schrödinger equation is not good enough to make quantum field theories. We have discussed two relativistic quantum equations, which both play a role in the quantum field theory behind the Standard Model, and discussed the work of Dirac and how he managed to find the correct equation to describe electrons and other fermions. One of the most significant aspects of the Dirac equation is probably the prediction of antimatter, and that this equation later became part of the foundation of QED, which is one of the best, if not the best, quantum field theory of all time. As always, I hope you learned something new and that you found it as interesting as I did. If you liked the content and want to support the channel, please check the link in the description. If you have any comments or questions, please put them in the comment section. As always, if you like the video, feel free to like, subscribe, and share it with your friends so they can also learn some cool physics. Stay tuned for the next video.